about, and Napoleon really comes to resent Dumas. And one example in terms of this sort of glamour factor that bothered Napoleon was when Dumas and Napoleon go to Egypt, and Napoleon takes Dumas, and Dumas is the cavalry command, supreme cavalry commander in Egypt, and Dumas the cavalry commander, and Napoleon's the commander of the force. But it is Napoleon's operation. They're marching across the desert to Alexandria, and I found, when I found the memoirs of the expedition's physician, it's basically Napoleon's doctor, who should have been writing nice things about him, and perhaps that's why these memoirs were never published in France. So I locate the memoirs, and the doctor has this wonderful description of what the French seem like to the Egyptians. The first time the Egyptians see the French army marching towards Alexandria, and they see this incredible man of color, as the physician says, this General Dumas, man of color, looking like a Greek god. Looking like a Greek god. And then behind him, they see this scrawny little guy who is our commander, Napoleon Bonaparte. And they cannot believe that Napoleon has a very high position. Yeah. And so they're sure that it's the tall black man who's leading the expedition. And things like this really infuriate
Things
Napoleon.
Were very rough, though, in Egypt. Food, people, and finally, without telling anyone, Napoleon leaves in the fastest, the best ship that he could leave from to come back to France.
Napoleon really betrays the army that he betrays the revolutionary army that he takes to Europe. Napoleon goes to, or sorry, takes to Egypt, excuse me. He goes to Egypt after the French revolutionary armies have really been fighting wars that we've forgotten now, but they were very important wars in Europe for the past 3 years, and Napoleon manages to kind of claw his way to the top, and he brings almost the entire force then to Egypt in this kind of crazy scheme to establish a French sort of revolutionary empire in the Middle East.
But they thought he was going to go to England.
The English are preparing for an invasion. But Napoleon decides that he wants to become the new Alexander the Great, and he actually writes about that. And he takes all of these revolutionary generals, these sort of red, white, and blue liberty, equality, fraternity generals like Alex Dumas, who really think they're fighting for the ideals of the revolution. He brings them to the middle of the desert, where, for one thing, they're all dropping like flies because of disease and everything else, and they're not prepared for it, but they also realize that they're there to kind of turn Napoleon into an emperor. And this is when actually Dumas confronts Napoleon, and that's when he becomes enemy number one, because he challenges Napoleon about why they're there in the desert. And then, as you say, as he leaves his best generals there, dying largely from disease, but also being attacked by every possible group in the Middle East, Napoleon himself realizes, well, it's not going to work my whole scheme about going and establishing a revolutionary empire that was going to stretch all the way to India. Let's forget about that, and I'll go back to France and stage a coup d'etat. And that's what he does.
What's interesting, too, this is when Dumas and another general, his compatriot there, get on an old ship that is leaking, and they figure out how to stop the leak, but they only get as far as Naples.
Even they don't even get all the way up to Naples. This is the great tragedy that, in fact, inspires the Count of Monte Cristo, something that I found in that incredible manuscript that General Dumas wrote that I found inside the safe, which is that while Napoleon takes a fast ship back to France and makes himself dictator, Dumas, in early 1799, gets on the boat with this fellow general who's sort of his adjunct assistant, and also this incredible scientist, the greatest geologist in the world.
That's the one thing that Napoleon did bring, these savants to Egypt.
These savants who are the greatest minds of France, he brings them to Egypt. It's all part of this idea of forming an empire, a new empire in the Middle East. It's an incredible story that I go into in the book, which I don't have time to, think, go into here, but it also has to do with the fact that the French Revolution has ended slavery. So therefore, their whole way that they funded the empire and funded the French kingdom and everything in France it's suddenly gone by the boards because they've decided they're not going to have slavery anymore. Mm-hmm. So they have to rejigger and create a new colonial system. So mm-hmm. the invasion of Egypt is all part of an idea of, you know, how can we create a new kind of more modern imperialism that doesn't depend on slavery.
Meanwhile, Dumas is arrested.
Well, Dumas's on this leaky ship and he gets to the south of Italy and he's arrested.
And he's thrown into the jail. The dungeon as a war prisoner. And for 2 years, even as a change of command goes on above him.
Yeah, it's not exactly. He is thrown in and the problem is that it's almost like a modern, in a modern context, we would say he's taken by a terrorist group.
Yeah.
It's not a state. It is, there's been, all of the Italian peninsula has been fought over between the revolutionary French forces and the Austrians, the Spaniards, and all kinds of forces that want to keep the French out and that want to keep modern ideas out of Italy, especially the south of Italy. And the force that takes him prisoner is this kind of crazy renegade but powerful force called the Holy Faith Army.
Yes.
And the Holy Faith Army, as I found out, was incredible. It's sort of a combination of the mafia, forces from sent by the Pope, and forces that support the exiled King of Naples. But there are really a lot of thugs involved with this group, and these are the guys who take Dumas. They throw him into a fortress on the coast that they've taken hold of. And he just languishes there. And when I went and visited that fortress, which is held by the Italian Navy now, an Italian admiral who runs it right now showed me around. And this guy spoke with great emotion because very few people know General Dumas' story. But because this military man, he controls the fortress now, he had read the documents of the people who'd been imprisoned there. And he had come across what they'd done to Dumas.
They tried to poison him.
They terrible things. And this guy told me that it was just a shame what we did to this man.
Not only that, but when he gets back, he doesn't have a sou. And nothing Napoleon will do. But please tell our friends what you wrote in this book about the coup d'etat, that Napoleon and his younger brother, Lucien, did to make him emperor.
Well, I mean, this is the really where Napoleon showed his true colors. So when he left Egypt, he basically arrived in France and created this little propaganda campaign to say that Egypt was a great triumph and I've left my triumphant troops in Egypt and I've come back to kind of clean up France, to kind of clean up, Dodge. And what France needs is, you know, an iron fist and all these, basically the playbook of a 20th century dictator. And he comes back in and with the help of his, as you say, his brother Lucien, who at that point is high up in the French Senate.
He's so, president of it, underage, besides.
Yeah, exactly. He's lied about his age to get in there. Well, the whole, everything with the Bonaparte family, it's all a gigantic family conspiracy to make everybody, essentially to take over France by pushing the career of their genius young genius brother Napoleon,
he gets all of these men who are part of the well, in Russia would be the Duma, but there it's what the Senate, and puts them in this big place to so you won't be disturbed.
Oh yeah, it's completely out of what Pinochet did in Chile. He basically puts them in this. He spreads false rumors saying that, you know, the government of France is going to be attacked. And Napoleon goes back quite a ways with this sort of tactic. He's first comes to really power in France or prominence when he ruthlessly suppresses this kind of uprising in a few years earlier in 1795 by basically being one of the few generals who's willing to just fire what they call grapeshot. It doesn't sound better than it is. Basically, he fires shrapnel into crowds in Paris and is willing to murder a few hundred people. Yeah. And a few years later, he basically goes and he and his brother spread this idea that France is in danger and the government has to move to this palace outside of Paris. They move to the palace. The next day, Napoleon basically brings cavalry guys that are his pals and they surround the palace and basically charge you know, they
kill them. Yeah.
Well, they don't have to kill them. They basically charge in and threaten to, and the politicians who first are give, you know, speeches about how they're not going to let a dictator take over, as soon as they have guys charging in with sabers and pointing guns at them, they kind of
now Napoleon
jump out the windows and give up.
Also rejects the whole concept of being a democracy where people of color exist with them on an equal share. He will not give Alex Dumas the money owed to him from his back salary. He will not allow people of mixed color be in, live in Paris.
Yes, all kinds of horrible racial restrictions, even worse than that. You know, by this point, the France is the most integrated country in the world, far, you know, in advance of anybody. They have, in a certain sense, kind of like a 21st century condition that they've created there. They have integrated schools in Paris that they're beginning. The head of the French Senate for a while was a black man.
But then, like Hitler, you can't go to school.
Yes, exactly. You have this, he lashes out at all of this. Yeah. And in fact, you kind of capture it in, you know, everybody admires the fact that Napoleon created this Legion of Honor, which is something the French still have. They're very proud of. Well, the very day after he established the Legion of Honor in France in 1802, he reinstated slavery, which was a betrayal of one of the great accomplishments of the Revolution, reinstated slavery throughout the French Empire and throughout France. And the same month then later, he imposed these horrible race laws on France, which were much worse than anything that had ever existed under the king.
Yeah.
And that really hit our hero, Dumas, so hard. And
Dumas
undid his
dies, what, 4 years later?
Yes.
With a four-year-old son named Alexander, who never forgot the love he felt for his father. And in going back to read the father's sort of memoirs or letters, creates
A few people we may have heard of, like D'Artagnan, Edmond Dantès in The Count of Monte Cristo, and many other characters in the novels of Dumas. When you learn the history and the, so we learn the story of his father, General Dumas, you just see he's taking incidents, he's taking the character of his father, which was just this wonderful kind of hot-headed but incredibly noble man. He just turns it into these wonderful heroes of fiction.
Will you autograph my book?
I have loved
reading it.
With pleasure.
If you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Visit your library. Support it. It's our finest democratic institution in America. And while you're there, look up The Count of Monte Cristo, The Man in the Iron Mask, or even the wonderful books that came from Alexander Dumas' pen. Support it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you, Tom.